the analog experience stuff is a reaction to the fact that we are now so digitized and so internalized and oftentimes kind of so alone with all of this stuff that, you know, the fear would be, oh, that's just what people are going to become. I think what's happening is people are actually really embracing experience more because they want to get out of that track.
Welcome to the Schmidt List, the podcast for people dedicated to managing successful projects, developing impactful products, and building engaged teams. And now, here's your host, Kurt Schmidt.
Jim, how are you today?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming. I want to talk to you a lot today about the work that you do. So tell me a little bit about Street Factory Media. What is it? What do you guys do? How long have you been around? You know, I love the name, by the way.
Oh, thank you. It's probably our biggest asset. it's really tough to explain what we do because we kind of are that point at the end of the marketing frontier where no one knows what else is left. Mm. So technically, I think we're an experiential marketing agency, but our hook is that we execute big ideas. So whatever you have written down on that napkin, you know, rattling around in your brain, we will then figure out how to make that come to life in a way that will actually allow consumers to touch your brand. So it's very tactile, real world type of marketing.
And how long have you guys been around?
Since 03. So 17 big ones.
Wow.
Yeah.
And
who knew?
Who knew? Well, and I've been to your space. It's amazing. It's this crazy workshop of people doing metal fabrication to painting and all this different stuff.
Yeah.
And that's what I find so fascinating, because really what I want to dive in with you is that very much like what the Work Foundry does, everything we do is custom.
Yeah.
You know, how does this work for you? Because it seems so, it's such a difficult conversation, because it's like you're sitting across from maybe this marketing person at Best Buy or something, and they're like, what do you guys do? And you're like, what do you want?
Yeah.
What do you want to have happen?
It's hard to sell that.
Yeah.
You know, you would think, oh, how amazing that you've built a company that can do anything. But try saying that in an elevator.
Yeah.
You know, it's really, we've got a 150-page deck that just kind of generally gives you an idea of things.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a marketing challenge for us. The good thing, that what has worked for us, is we've kind of just, we don't necessarily do sales. We have kind of gone viral. So it's sort of like people at an ad agency or people, you know, in a marketing department at a brand, it's sort of like saying, you know, do you know a good handyman? That's us. And so we kind of, that's sort of how we work. And yeah, it is custom. And so, you know, from a, not just a sales perspective, but how do you go about your work and organize your work? That's also a huge challenge.
Yeah. I mean, we were recently just having a conversation with a client, and they're like, can you show me an example of a time that you worked in this sort of warehouse, WMS sort of platform and this? And we're like, no, but everything you're saying is in pieces in these three different projects that we've done before. But what I found is that, again, and I suffer from this, you might suffer from, but I mean, if we don't see what we see, it's hard to say, I want that thing when you're not a creative.
There's no sales floor, you know, it's
right.
Show me your SUVs. Show me your.
Right.
You know,
exactly. Right. Right.
It's really about. The onus is on, I mean, I think we have a great deck of work we've
done.
Yeah,
I mean, you guys have been around for 17 years. You've got a ton of work to show off.
And there's like amazing stuff that I forget we did. But it's everything is so custom that, you know, so we work with a lot of great creative agencies. And sometimes when they pitch an idea and you say, oh, yeah, we've done something just like that, they get kind of bummed out. It's like, oh, right. So this is a hackneyed idea. I get it. Okay.
We get the table scraps.
Yeah. I mean, I think we embrace that challenge of kind of jumping off the building and inventing the parachute on the way down. But it is tough to sort of sell that.
Yeah.
So.
Well, and you mentioned other creative partners. I can imagine, you know, somebody is working with like Fallon's working with Arby's or something.
Yep.
And they're like, hey, we want to do this crazy in-store thing or out in the parking lot type of thing. And Fallon, well, we don't do that work. So,
yeah,
then knowing that you exist.
Yes. And that is our challenge, is we want to let agencies know that they can not just say yes to their client, but say yes to other creatives in their shop. I mean, I started out on the client side, and we would have, you know, amazing creative ideas from our agencies, but really no idea how to execute those, carry them out, build them, activate them. And so they just went in the wastebasket.
Right.
So what we want, you know, not just our, all of our clients know is you can, we're giving you that range to really, and what's happening for us too is what used to be kind of non-traditional marketing is now experiential marketing. It's becoming its own thing. And just about, I mean, you walk into a grocery store and just about every brand on the shelf is probably wanting to do something that's experiential in that the consumer can actually interact with the brand, touch it, get a better sense of its full personality.
Yeah, the story behind it,
and so
why it exists.
Yeah, so the world is going there, and so we're not having to evangelize about how cool that kind of marketing is anymore. What we're just trying to reassure folks is we can actually carry it out in an artful way, a very precise way. You know, we work with – I tell my staff, and when you're working with creatives – they're designing these experiences, you know, at a thousand times magnitude on a computer screen. So when they show up at the shop and they're seeing little tiny flaws, don't be surprised because they don't really care about the real world. It's got to look exactly the way it looked in their head. So
right, yeah,
that's a tough client. And so you got to kind of build your operation accordingly.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. I mean, I can imagine over the years you've learned so much about how to set good expectations up front about what's going to happen and how it's going to work and how you folks work and everything. Because, I mean, again, unlike us, we're working in code and design. We can make changes pretty quickly. But once it gets into the code, it starts to become more solidified and becomes much more expensive to change and things. But you're literally dealing with people welding stuff together.
Right.
And somebody comes in and says, we need to change this, but we still need it for the event tomorrow.
Yeah.
Something
we've gotten much better at managing those expectations, and it's not sort of like, hey, I know you want a 10, but we can give you a 5. It's more like, let's conceive of this thing together now that you've shared this idea in a way that isn't just feasible and on budget, but be really cool and interesting to consumers. So there's that kind of, and then once you get on the same page on that, then there's really should be no surprises by the time you get to the launch page or the launch date. Now, for me, initially, it was just always yes, 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 yes. And that you're not, when you're doing that, you're not doing a very good job as a partner or managing expectations. So that's a learning, you know.
Yeah.
And 17 years in, we're kind of the way there, I would say.
Well, I can imagine you, just like us, you work better when you're partnering with people, not a vendor, where you're part of the solution, not just taking orders.
Yeah. Yes and no. I mean, I would say
because you probably have 17 years of experience, you should be able to contribute something to the experience.
You'd hope so. but, you know, it's we position ourselves because I did gain some early perspective in life as a client. One thing I learned was agencies don't seem to work well with agencies. So we are not an agency. We're definitely a shop.
Yeah.
You know.
Yep.
It's the anti-agency in a lot of ways, but we're set up to work with agencies and brands direct. But it's probably 70% of what we do is with the agencies, which is fun because then you're really just dealing with the idea.
Yeah,
you're not so invested in the business side and all that stuff. But so, I guess you know. What was the question?
Well, it's about working better as a partner, right?
Oh, yeah, the partner vendor thing. Sometimes that works. I mean, sometimes it's good to have someone with a strong vision, and then you want to present yourself as, hey, we're the plumbers. That's who we are in this industry, is we're the plumbers.
But you also have to be in a place where you feel very confident you can execute.
Right? So with some time, you get better at that. And so many times, can we swear on this show?
Absolutely.
Okay, we've gotten bitten in the ass when we've kept our mouth shut. And I, you know, that's what I tell our lead fabricator will often say, you know, I knew that was going to not work out. It's like, well, that's why they're hiring us. You know, you need to speak up. They trust us to be the expert. They've never worked in this space before.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, again, I've dealt with that over the years. Software developers, same thing. It's like, well, I knew this wasn't going to be a good idea. And it's like, well, why?
Yeah. And yet I just carried it out.
I just marched off the cliff with everybody else because that's what everybody else is doing. And I thought this thing. But, yeah, you know, I think that's an important thing about it starts in the hiring process where you're looking for people that are going to be able to get work done, but are independent thinkers, are not going to just drive you off the cliff. Mm-hmm. But it's something you kind of like, you have to keep grooming with folks. You have to constantly be coaching them.
Yeah. It's a mixed bag because I went to a military high school and I kind of have this military methodology of running our organization, and it's really worked. I mean, it's not that we're super hierarchical. We're certainly not shooting anyone.
Yep.
But you know, this is the plan. These are your orders. Carry them out. So there's a ton of that that's just important. You know, it's the do your job thing. But then, of course, you want it all. But also, you know, think outside the box, and we'd love to hear your ideas and all that. So there's a sweet spot there.
Right.
And it's just part of that throttle that from a management perspective, you're always being attentive to. And it varies from person to person. Some people are great at that. Some people mm-hmm. just give me the orders and I'll take that hill.
Right. Some people you have to talk to every day. Some mm-hmm. people once a year.
Some people whose opinion you trust more.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep.
Yep. There's some people I don't want to hear their opinions. There's right. some people I really want to know what they think about this project.
Right.
So
yep.
all kind of that management, you know, I think of it always as throttling. You
sure.
know, it's tough to have a one-size-fits-all
yeah.
way of managing people. They're so different. And again, one thing you learn over time is, you know, sometimes you'll give up on someone if they don't fit your idea of what the
sure.
perfect employee is. And I think the older you get, the more you do this, you realize – okay, that's their kind of weird personality, but they're adding so much value. I'm going to figure out how to
right.
accommodate this.
It could be a culture add in the
yeah,
not just a distraction.
Yeah,
if we can embrace this,
and so our staff, I come to that conclusion, but then I've got to tell the team, it's yeah. like, okay, this person's different, but that's okay because I can tell you they're adding a ton of value to the team, and mm-hmm. so. Right. That's you know, that I guess that's a learning after over a decade.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and so do you have a philosophy around hiring? How is there a way that, you know, Jim, I know in 30 seconds whether or not you'd be a good fit
yeah.
or is there what's the kind of Jim's philosophy around now?
So when you walk into our office, we've got about a 20-foot, I guess, doormat. It's like a big rug with our brand on it. I always say by the time you get to the end of that rug, I pretty much know if this is going to work or not. So, yes.
Is it the gate that
it's
they
not
have
quite
when
30,
they're walking?
Yeah, it's like, not. Yeah, it's just there's a certain,
I don't think it's gate,
there's an
it's,
aura, you know.
Okay.
So it's not 30 seconds. That's way too long. I'd say it's more, maybe 10 seconds.
Okay.
But that being said, I'm wrong half the time. And so what we've kind of found, it's really tough. You can suss the certain things out in an interview. You can create a certain HR process, and that is helpful. I mean, we used to just hire on the spot and live with it.
Well, this is to give you more context. This is why I asked, because I mean, this isn't something where you go and get a 4-year degree and,
right.
and then you leave and you go to Street Factory Media
yeah.
or even a 2-year trades degree. So like,
no, I mean, it's.
So hiring for you is it much like I said, like us, it's gotta be, you've got to have a secret sauce there.
It's
right?
a thing, you know, and I have found that some of the greatest hires have been waiters and waitresses, people who can multitask, handle pressure.
Mm-hmm. Customer facing.
You know, yeah, there's exactly, you know, great engagement skills, mm-hmm. all that stuff. You know, but we've got ex-rappers and artists, and it's really a gamut of people that we hire. But, you know, what it goes back to is you got to start doing the work to really show that this is for you. You almost have to kind of be an oddball or dysfunctional mm-hmm. to really get into this kind of work just because of the hours and the stress. And it's a lifestyle more than the job. I mean,
right.
I don't know if that's a cliche, but you really have to kind of, you know, most of the people are young and they've got the time to give to it. And frankly, being at Street Factory is where they want to hang out most of the time anyway. So that's
sure.
that's great.
Yeah.
But there's a high burnout rate for sure. But as you get in, it's sort of, I think the management philosophy is let's fail quickly if we have to. And you know, if it's not working out, I'll tell people, it's like, this really isn't about you as a person. It's just the fit thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that it's not working out probably means you're a very healthy, well-adjusted human being. And you should go find yeah. something else to do. Yeah.
Do you meet people you really like and you're like, don't apply here. Don't apply.
Well, like my kids, yes. I would never want my sons to do this.
Stay away from this.
Yeah.
Well, okay. So that's good employees. But how about good partners? What are some traits when you're first meeting with those agencies or people that you can tell this is going to be really good or this is going to be a mess?
It's really about, it's tough sometimes if they've never done live before.
Okay.
Because, you know, maybe they're used to sitting on sets and shooting a take 30 times for a TV spot or, you know, touching up a photograph for a billboard, you know, for 10 days. But this is live. And, you know, you have to sort of accept that aspect of the presentation.
Mm-hmm.
And some people are totally cool with that. They've done it enough. I guess sometimes you get a little bit ivory towered into hell where they're just sort of this is sort of a fussiness factor, not willing to get off of their vision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we'll give advice about feasibility and, you know, flow and run of show and things like that. But that wasn't their vision.
Okay.
So they, you know, they can show up with a bad idea, frankly. And if we kind of try to coach them around that and they don't really want to listen to that,
yeah,
that can be a problem.
Yeah, that's a red flag for you.
Yeah. I think to the extent, and it doesn't even have to be like partner to part, treat us like a partner, but at least treat us like a vendor that has done this before.
Right. Has done this for 17 years.
Because we're just trying to help.
Right.
Because at the end of the day, if this doesn't go well, whether it was our fault or not, you're not going to come back. And we want you to come back. I mean, well, that's what we're always building.
That's the other thing I was going to say is because the impact that it has on the people that it touches is so much more than a billboard or a banner ad,
yeah,
or things like that. Because you're in the physical space.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, I mean, I have so many questions about that, Jim, because you have to sometimes you have to staff this place.
Oh, yeah.
Who takes responsibility always for that?
Who's, so we do basically
like you're the police.
The assembly line is everything from the experiential design up front, which even if you've got the idea,
yeah,
we need to further design that experience. And then it goes to fabrication. What are the kind of amusements or customized props that we're going to sort of create for consumers to engage with this brand? And that can be anything from steel to wood to acrylic to digital to screens. It's everything.
Yeah.
Then you get into now you get into sort of game day execution, the activation side, you know, what's happening for permits and locations and security and staff, you know, who is the face of this experience? We handle all that as well.
Okay.
And then, and I think it's becoming more and more important as digital social, you know, the impact of that grows is let's capture this content for a broader audience.
Right.
So we've got a whole content team in-house that works with the team from the beginning, from the experiential design phase all the way through. So when consumers do start interacting with this cool thing in Times Square, we're also getting really great brand content mm-hmm. for their platforms. And then we're also sort of strategizing that back end as, okay, what are you going to do with this cool content? How are you going to cut it up? 6 seconds. And it's a lot of 6 second type of
sure.
vignettes.
Yeah.
So that, I think one thing that sets us apart is we sort of, that's all in-house. You know, we're not sort of brokering this out to fabrication companies or
contractors.
So, and so we work really well as an integrated team, but we also get hired to do one of those things mm-hmm. or two of those things.
Yep.
It just depends what the project is. So that really helps in terms of that cohesiveness of creating the whole basic experience.
And that's what you tell people up front. We can offer you the whole
yep.
suite of things. We can just take your idea and make it real and you just show up and
yeah,
enjoy it.
Yeah.
But that's the thing is then how have you found ways? And again, for us, I think, you know, because we're dealing with digital more often, prototype and testing is pretty quick and easy for us. I mean, somewhat. But how have you found ways to prototype or test things? You're going to do this big installation on Nicollet Mall out
yeah.
there and you don't know what it's going to be to walk through the
right.
experience. How do you prototype and test that stuff without having to build things 6-7 times?
You don't. I mean, that's the problem. You don't. I mean,
it's mostly in paper and the
we're
computer,
doing
right?
this massive 26,000 square foot build in Miami right now for the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And, you know, we designed it. We're pretty sure we know how it's going to work. You know, we've had engineers look at it,
mm-hmm.
but we haven't built it in a warehouse beforehand.
Right.
You know, and we've got the thing about live is those deadlines are hard.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And everything is a prototype. Like everything's a prototype and it's generally done once.
Yep.
I mean, we do a lot of tours, but generally it's a 1 to 2 day activation. So it is a, and I think a lot of times, tough to communicate from a pricing standpoint
mm-hmm.
is, you know, we're creating a prototype here. So it's not just your usual thing that you might have a idea in your head might cost, but we've got to do all that R&D. And we do a lot of engineering work to
sure.
make sure it's, you know, it's not going to damage anyone.
Right, it's not going to fall over.
We have an insurance guy too.
Well, as you should. I mean, mm-hmm. These are physical spaces.
Hi, Bernie. Right?
Well, and that's interesting to me is because that means you have to be. I mean, you have to be that much more planful because it is kind of one and done.
Yeah.
Sort of thing. I mean, I'm guessing there's times where certain pieces maybe end up in a store or something somewhere or whatever. But for the most part, you're tearing it all down at the end.
Yeah. And that's, you know, we do have a hoarding problem, too. So that doesn't help. Well, what happens, too, a lot of times is the client will build this thing and it's amazing. And they'll say, oh, we can't throw that away. Can you guys store this for us?
Yeah. No, that's we work with some trade show places and that's the same.
Yeah. And then they forget about it. And next thing you know, I mean, we're at least getting paid to store it. But so it really is. There's a certain disposability to it all, which, you know, is just part of it. It's just sort of a Hollywood movie type of thing.
Yeah.
Although we're looking at interesting ways we can start repurposing some things vinyl into products.
Mm-hmm.
Because we want to come up with a way to sort of, you know, more sustainably.
Yeah.
You know,
less waste and stuff. Well, because again, like I said, like, it's not like everything is going to now be sent to China and be mass reproduced, you know, 5,000 times.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not that kind of prototype. And so, it gets back to, you know, that's why I do like to say, it's like, man, if you're going to do this, let's put it on tour.
Right.
You know, and we often
take it on the road.
We often do. And we also, it's why I think content is important. It's like, if we're investing so much into this live moment, and granted, it's an amazing brand impression, but it may only be 1,000 people. You know, let's push this out to 50,000 people.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, content is becoming more and more important, not just to us. It always has been, but also to our clients.
Yeah.
So generally speaking, most of our programs have a content component and a way to share that out.
Yeah, because it's very different now. I mean, I know the people that are in marketing listening will be like, oh, yeah, duh. But it's like.
You'd think.
But it's like you said, if I'm filming, say, these testimonials of people going through this experience, the videos I'm going to post on Instagram are going to be very different than the videos I post on Facebook, very different than I do on Twitter, or very different than I do on YouTube, very different than I do on my own website. And so more and more people seem to be understanding that now. And so I can tell what you're saying. You can turn one piece of good content into 1,000 pieces, but with just taking that installation and moving it to a store in Virginia for the weekend, you can double your money. You know what I mean? Double your impressions. So
yeah.
It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. And sometimes it makes sense to, there's sort of geographic needs for certain brands, you know, from a sales standpoint or whatever.
Right.
So, tours are great in terms of just being able to replicate the experience. And of course, you get better at it each time. I mean, you're definitely going to have a better activation date, you know, stop two than stop one.
Yeah.
You're working out kinks. And so if it's a one-day activation, you want to get those kinks worked out really quick.
That's what I was going to say, because there's no real standardization in what you're doing either, because sidewalks are different sizes and curbs are different heights. And because, again, you're putting them a lot of times in highly trafficked areas for the most part.
And the other thing, so that's a huge stressor in this business. And the other one, too, is we just don't have a lot of time.
Yeah.
Even or budget. So
because by the time they probably come to you, they probably should have come to you.
Oh, I mean,
months,
you know,
earlier.
A lot of people are working on these 6-month time horizons. And it's like we're typically 3 to 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so you've got to really draw up a play quick based on your experience. I know this is going to work well.
Yeah.
And land it and then quickly fix the things you need to adjust
that
weren't anticipated. So your ability to adjust, I think, is as important as your ability to sort of know in advance what's going to happen. And so you just kind of rinse and repeat that format. But it is, you know, we were talking about the fact that we just don't do the same thing twice. There's this chaos theory that you just build into your model.
Oh, sure.
You know, there's no way, if you're Anderson Windows, you can be so efficient on how you construct those windows day
Absolutely.
In and day out.
Yep.
If you're making something completely new out of someone's imagination every week, it's... There's a certain amount of chaos you just have to be comfortable with and live with. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and then, you know, so you'd mentioned when you're working with these sorts of clients, can you give me an example of an installation you're really proud of and how that experience went?
You know, one of the first ones that we ever did that I'm to this day very proud of was the giant Powerballs that sort of ostensibly, you know, fell from the sky onto these cars. Yeah. And so, you know, just what I love about that is it's an example of not just an amazingly dramatic moment that we were able to fabricate, but the fact that we could actually park those cars on Hennepin Avenue and just plug the meter.
Yeah.
And now you've got this amazing media experience
that's
totally unexpected, you know, totally discoverable.
Mm-hmm.
You've got, you know, this dry ice, you know, this fog coming out from it like it's about to explode at some point. And of course, this is all before social media. So you're only getting that moment.
Yeah.
But that would be something that if you did today, you'd be all over the place with organic sharing.
People picking up on it.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. The, you know, for me, I think that's what, you know, I mean, at least according to the stuff that I read, is that experience is starting to outweigh price for people's decision making more so, especially the younger generation, is that just because it costs more, if it's a better experience, people, my parents, it's price.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
But my daughter, who's 20, it's definitely, she weighs in the experience way over, is it going to, am I going to have to work some more hours, but I have a better experience?
Right. Yeah. It's, I think with younger people, experience obviously is really important. And we are, to the extent, we're a very analog company. You know, it's what do you touch and feel and build and present in the real world. And it's three dimensional, which is not to, and that's been very successful, which is not to say that it's not still a digital world.
Yeah.
I think the analog experience stuff is a reaction to the fact that we are now so digitized and so internalized and oftentimes kind of so alone with all of this stuff that, you know, the fear would be, oh, that's just what people are going to become. I think what's happening is people are actually really embracing experience more because they want to get out of that track a little bit and actually touch the thing and play with the thing and better understand the thing. So I think there is that appreciation for experience, which is not to say that, I mean, price is still super important.
Yep.
But I do think that, you know, people will value shop like crazy so they can then afford an experience. So I think it is kind of a best of both worlds. And it's kind of why we say experiential should definitely be 5 to 10% of your media plan.
Mm-hmm.
Let consumers touch your brand. I mean, which you can do on a mass scale. And I love traditional advertising. You know, I'm just a student of it, and that's where I came up. But
sure.
If you can also bring your brand into the real world and let people interact with it, that's just like the icing on the cake.
You get a lot more bang for your buck, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what's a typical engagement? Who's a good client? If I'm listening to this and I'm like, wow, I really like the stuff those folks are doing, is it typically a mid-sized to large agency that you work with? People that have been around for a while?
Is it all across the board? It really is across the board.
Okay.
We work with a lot of media buying companies because way back in the day, before there was such a word as experiential, we were just sort of classified as out-of-home media. And so, you know, I want to buy some billboards and then I want to do some street teams and I want to maybe do this crazy prop that sort of came alive off the billboard. So we work with a lot of media buying companies, and each one is fun and challenging for their own reasons. The media buying companies are great because they're really going to let you do your thing.
Yeah.
They just, you know, have a hard time putting into their Excel spreadsheets.
Yeah. they know what they're good at.
Yeah. Agencies are probably my favorite just because that's where you're getting so much creative firepower.
Mm-hmm.
And we work with agencies across the country, and they're, you know, they're the biggest, best agencies, and then these really small agencies, and they're all equally amazingly creative.
Mm-hmm.
So that's fun. The fun thing about working for brands direct, we do a lot of work for Caribou, for instance, is they just come to you and say, turn it loose. You guys can be the creatives on this one. And so, you know, we can sort of come up with some fun ideas on our own and really own the whole experience.
Mm-hmm.
So it's nice to have that mix. The way I think we're built is very well suited for creative agencies, and that's probably, well, obviously that's the majority of our clients, and I really like that. You know, I think that's, we like the crazy deadlines, and we like
ideas.
Getting that really cool idea and then take it from here.
Yeah. So. Well, and again, on top of that, it's like that's the whole logistics side of it. Like I was mentioning, because my head always goes back to permits and
insurance,
staffing, all stuff, right? All the boring stuff,
location scouting,
but all the stuff that'll pop your balloon in 2 seconds.
Right? Exactly. Yeah. And a lot of times, especially these small agencies, they will get scrappy and look at their creative director out there, producing the event on the ground. And they're like, okay, never again.
No, yeah, right. Yeah. We've learned.
Right, right.
Yeah. I mean, you could tell. I mean, we do the same thing here. Is we can, we'll do it with people with audits in a case where they might want some custom software, and we'll come in and we'll say we'll also audit what is some off the shelf things you could also have, and so we can give you the pros and cons of, well, you could just go and get this thing from Microsoft, but it only solves about 60% of your problems versus this custom thing, which would be more expensive, but it solves 110% of your problems, right? And giving people those options based on the experience you have, you get this sort of thing, because who would be a competitor to Street Factory Media? Who's, you know, well, who are you competing against?
It's kind of weird. Matt and I, my business partner, we really are into keeping our head down. We don't want to even know who the competition is. That's such a major distraction.
Sure.
But basically, there's the big mammoth, you know, almost like the Walmarts of our industry, like GMR and these big companies that do, you know, multi-million dollar turnkey programs for Budweiser and things like that. So there's those guys, and we usually don't mess in their neighborhood, and they don't mess in ours much either, just because we're kind of in that mid-level boutique situation. And then, I don't know, there are some companies that really specialize, that some will do like a ton of food sampling and things like that.
Okay.
There's not many that I've encountered that have that kind of soup to nuts with fabrication at the heart of it all, under one roof type of setup. Mm-hmm. So that allows us to move so quickly and with so much agility.
Right.
And even agility within a budget parameter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm sure you're frustrated when someone comes to you and says, hey, we want to do X and we figure it should cost Y. So that's the budget.
Yep.
And you're like, well, how would you even have come up with that number?
Right. Where'd that number come from?
So we have to back into so many numbers. It's nuts.
Oh, yeah.
And
yep.
Generally speaking, we either make it work or we kind of take a bath on it.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I get it. Yeah. Well, again, it comes back to, is there an opportunity here that's strategic too? Well, I mean, we haven't worked with this place before, and it'd be great to work with them. And
the icebreaker.
It elevates us. So that's worth investing into.
Well, we do so much. We have this engine and we got to feed the engine.
Yep.
So we constantly need momentum.
Yeah,
we're doing, you know, 10 to 15 projects a week. And mm-hmm. so because of that, we can sort of, you know, we can take a cut on one. We might make it up on another one.
Yeah.
You're developing a relationship. You're training your staff.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're training your partner too. They probably, in most cases, they haven't done a lot of this.
Next time, let's do it this way.
This way we both will make money.
But, you know, movement is good and lack of movement is terrifying.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah.
So speaking of movement, like what's next for Street Factory Media? Is there other areas you want to expand into? Is there other things you want to, you know, do? What's next in your mind's eye?
I think the next big thing for this year is we're heading west. Mm-hmm. So we're going to open up shop in LA. We've got some space camps right now in Portland and Dallas.
Okay.
And so we really want to head west. We've got so many great relationships out there. We feel like we need a little more base.
Yeah.
And so that's going to open up a lot of cool stuff in the entertainment industry and tech. So that's pretty exciting for us.
Yeah. So when you're thinking like fabrication and stuff out west?
We'll always fabricate here.
Yeah. Okay.
Because even if you're working with an agency or a client in LA, they may mm-hmm. be activating something in Atlanta.
I see. Okay.
Or New York. So being in the middle of the country is really been amazing for us.
Yeah. Right.
Actually, being in Minneapolis has been amazing for us because this is such a robust creative community.
So many agencies here.
Yeah. So we got lucky with that. You know, just being born here, we got lucky.
And yeah.
It really works well from, I mean, this is an amazing employee pool, mm-hmm. this market.
Lots of creatives.
It's affordable. Mm-hmm. You know, we can compete really well against companies on the East and West Coast on pricing. So, yeah, this has been great. But so we'll always fabricate here. I mean, we want to triple the size of our fabrication shop here, but West Coast will really be more of kind of a activation producer and
like management, kind of
business development side,
managing the project and stuff like that. Smart.
Yeah.
It's cool. Well, Jim, I learned so much today. I want to thank you for taking the time to join me. This
thank
is a
you
lot
for
of
having
fun.
Me.
No, this has been great. So if I want to know more about Street Factory Media,
probably, just streetfactorymedia.com. There's a lot of cool updated stuff happening on our social channels. So those buttons are on that page.
Yeah. A lot of cool stuff on the Instagrams.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah. Big parties planned for this year.
It's coming. Wait for it. We don't have the theme yet, but it's going to be, it will once again be epic.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, Jim, again, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to The Schmidt List. If you want to learn more about how Foundry accelerates innovation, check out foundrymakes.com. And if you'd like me to speak about establishing a growth mindset at your conference or with your team, drop me a note at kurt@foundrymakes.com. Oh, and the next time you're on the internet, head to iTunes and leave the show a review. If you enjoyed this episode, please share it with a friend, because sharing is caring. I truly appreciate you taking the time to listen to the show, and I hope you have a fantastic week.